Bhairappa ji, some of the points that you have made regarding education in the vernaculars are well taken, but I would like to highlight certain problematics which is inherent into your speech or in your certain positions that you have taken. One of which is you seem to be saying that Sanskrit is the mother of all Indian languages. Now I think that statement is essentialist in nature, in the sense that all the Indian languages developed, not by the support of Sanskrit language or not by drawing from the Sanskrit language, but it was by agitating against Sanskrit language, because Sanskrit essentially was the language of spirituality, and it was monopolized by the upper castes in the society. So that is something I want you to explain. And secondly,
let me answer your first question, and then you will ask your second question.
No, my second question is in connection with the first question.
Yes.
The second position you seem to be taking is you say that the proliferation of English language in academia and otherwise in present day India is something to be critiqued and interrogated thoroughly. But my point is that English is occupying a position today which Sanskrit occupied in the ancient India. Both languages are the languages of power, languages of monopoly, language of money. So, and most importantly, both these languages, in fact, Sanskrit used to be the language of exclusion. It did not have access to Dalit.
I have understood the question. Let me answer your question.
But the English, on the other hand, has...
No, I have understood the sociology behind your question.
Yeah.
Let me answer.
Yeah.
Let me answer. What I mean to say is, I never say that Sanskrit should be the medium of instruction. Impossible. I say mother tongue, see, the two are different units. Just because it is, that's why I have said section 1, section 2, section 3. Section 1, I have spoken about the Indian economy. Indirectly it is connected with the medium of instruction. Sanskrit also is indirectly connected with the medium of instruction. I maintain that medium of instruction should be Sanskrit. But if you go to higher and higher, there must be technical terminology should be in the mother tongue. Sanskrit is the most suitable, Sanskrit has the most suitable technical terminologies, because all these are scientific terminologies. And in our tradition, we have got certain words in Sanskrit. I have mentioned here that in 1967 or 68, I attended a technical terminology commission held by the UGC in Delhi. And there they discovered that in almost all Indian languages, science terminologies are almost the same. Except some regional variations. Now what happens is, if these terminologies are used with some commonality, a science book written by a Bengali can be easily understood by a Kannada man or a Marathi or a Hindi man, provided it is written in the common script. A science book written by a Kannada man can easily be understood by the Hindi man, because as you go to higher and higher level in language, language becomes less and less descriptive, more and more symbolic. That is why we can develop our own science and our own thinking, instead of depending entirely on English language. Now, we say, if we do not have a complete mastery over the English language, what will happen to our learning of science? What do the Germans do? What do the Japanese do? What do the other European languages do? Now, we have to develop our own Indian science, Indian languages, and through this, retaining our the identity of our mother tongue, we can also develop common Indian science terminologies. That is what I mean. I don't say that Sanskrit should become the medium of instruction throughout. It's impossible. You see, there is a streak of sociology in your question, saying now English is dominating, once upon a time Sanskrit was dominating, and both of them are exploiting, etc. See, this sociology is unacceptable.
Sir, I'm from Karnataka only, Shreyanka. My point was, you had noted the economic changes and the economy of the country after independence during 60s and 70s, which is otherwise, which were already documented in your writings of Sakshi Parva, which were columns. So my question is, today we have been in the age of globalization. We cannot deny it. The fact is, we want fair globalization to be established. But at the same time, I found there could have been some mentioning about present scenario of the country. Yes, you are backing, I should say, the well-constructed theory, which suggested the capitalization, how it is controlling our whole society. I am from the very rural background of Karnataka. I can say that how the yellow buses entering the villages, they are not just destroying the very Kannada schools, but also the cultures which is there in the families. That completely the structure has been changing. The changing structure may be like you know, we are using soya bean because some American company says that coconut oil is so much cholesterol or so much called, you know, these kind of things. First point I mentioned, yes, how today's government is tackling the effect. And secondly, when we see, yes, there are some states like Tamil Nadu. Let me finish. There are some states like Tamil Nadu, which have tried and which have succeeded in bringing in the whole technical education and medical education in the mother tongue. Why such kind of initiations have not taken by other states also?
You see, the first unit of my lecture is addressed to our literary writers. Soon after we got independence, economic leftist, that means Marxism, distribution of wealth, became the dominant theme of our literary writers. But gradually we realized, that means, that this state-controlled economy and suppressing the individual enterprise has pushed our country into utter poverty, and it became inevitable for us to become a country of free enterprise. Now, even after we have witnessed the inevitability of free enterprise, our intellectuals and our literary writers have not reconciled themselves to the philosophy of free enterprise. Our literary writers have not reconciled. This is all the point I am pointing out. I am not going into other details of economics because I am not a professor of economics, and this is not a thesis on economics.
English in mother tongue, fine, till this education should be imparted in mother tongue, till has school level, fine. Now question is, if the parents of the children is in government office and is transferred from his own state to another state, now the children will face the problem, because India, a multilingual country like India, has different languages in different states. Then how do they cope up with that? Next one, just now I came to know from my previous speaker that the Tamil Nadu government has introduced engineering curriculum in mother tongue. Now, in that way, we need not be confined to that only Tamil Nadu, and the speaker of other languages, other states, won't be able to get entrance there because they don't know Tamil.
I understand your question. You are speaking of the problem of transferable central government officials. What is the percentage of such people? And what is the percentage of the other people? Now, the solution to the problem of the transferable central government servants, you are imposing on the rest of the population. Aren't you? Take the speaker.
They are minority, but of course they are less in number. But how will their problem be solved?
No. The problem is, you see, for this only central government has started central schools and send your children to central schools. But what is the what is the percentage of the people? Now, you see, what happened is, first the problem started, the transferable central government. I worked in a college called Regional College of Education, which is a constituent of NCERT. And Regional College of Education has a school called demonstration schools, where educational experimentation is to take place. That is up to high school. Now, in demonstration schools, the medium of instruction became English, because English is considered to be the all India language. Now, who should be the students for that? The government decided the children of transferable central government servants should be admitted. Now, they were admitted. But then, those who were working in the regional college, employees who were not transferable also demanded, let our children also be admitted. They were admitted. And then class 4 servants also said, when the children of the professors and readers and lecturers are admitted, why not our children? They went on strike. They also were admitted. So this way, and some influential citizens said, they brought their influence, political influence, their children also got the admission. Now this way, private colleges, private schools said, we will follow your syllabus only, central syllabus only, give us permission. Permission was given because, you know, political influence also. This way it went on multiplied. Now, where do you stop? Where do you stop? That means the pattern, the model becomes the model which was built for the benefit of the transferable central government servants. Suppose you are working in Delhi. You are a central government servant. Theoretically, you are transferable, but most probably you will not be transferred. Therefore, you are a Delhiite. Send your children to the school where the local language is Hindi. Admit it. And also you demand that your child be taught your mother tongue, either Kannada, Tamil or Telugu, as a language. But medium of instruction here should be Hindi, and same should be applied in other states also. There are many central government offices and central government institutions in various other states also, and their children, they always maintain psychologically that they don't belong to that state. They work there, they get the site, they get the house under the state quota because they are staying there, but they don't allow their children to study in the local language. This mentality of the central government officers mentality has very much influenced our medium of instruction policy.
Sir, may I make one? Yes. I hail from the state of Kerala. Kerala. I am an advocate in the Supreme Court. Your speech is very highly enlightening speech. We are very grateful to you, sir. And you said that before independence, the Sanskrit used to be given more importance in the schools than today. So I have a great respect for Sanskrit, and I learned Gita. I am a student of Gita, and I sing Bhagavad Gita with the guitar. Probably I am the only person in the world, to the best of my knowledge and belief, who sings Bhagavad Gita with the guitar. Three chapters I by heart. And what is that? How can we bring back that glory of Sanskrit today?
No. My purpose is not to bring back the glory of Sanskrit. I have made it very clear. Elementary knowledge of Sanskrit is necessary for the growth of our languages. I am not speaking of mere Kannada. For a person to know good Hindi, knowledge of Sanskrit is necessary. For a person to know good Bengali, elementary knowledge of Sanskrit is necessary. To know Marathi, to know Gujarati, to know Punjabi, whatever the languages. I am only saying that at least up to high school, elementary knowledge of Sanskrit is necessary. And from the higher education point of view, what happens is, if you have elementary knowledge of Sanskrit and later on you want to do some research in history, you can develop that elementary knowledge easily and then go to original in historical sources in Sanskrit. You want to do research in sociology, you can develop it and go to original sources in Sanskrit. You want to do research in anything, and you want to write some science books in your mother tongue, that elementary level will help you. That is why I am only saying elementary in Sanskrit should be taught. What happens is, when a child is young, to know the elementary language, terminology, Amarakosha, and then Karaka especially, it should be by-hearted. And when you grow up, you don't have the patience, and it becomes very difficult for you to know the elementary structure of Sanskrit. Therefore, why don't you teach it when a child is very capable of knowing it? That is all I am saying, because it helps our education. And to become a literary writer, if you don't have elementary knowledge of Sanskrit, you cannot read our ancient Indian languages. Not only that, you cannot develop your own language. Knowledge of Sanskrit gives precision and depth and clarity to our language. Whatever the language, it may be Kannada, it may be Bengali, or whatever the languages. That's all I am pleading for. I am not saying Sanskrit should dominate, etc. No.
The observations that you have made and the anxieties that you have expressed are known anxieties. In fact, these anxieties have been expressed by many thinkers, scholars, since a long time. But my point is, I think there is another dimension to the whole debate. In a country like India, English is also a means of liberation. Remember what Kuvempu, the great poet laureate of Kannada, said. He's the first recipient of Gnanapith Award. He said, "If I had not read English, I would have been carrying cow dung on my head." I think when we talk about...
I got your point. Because I come from the state of Kuvempu.
Yeah, because I also come from the same state. That's why I wanted to bring in Kuvempu here. English is also a means of liberation in India. That's one. So that's why we should, discuss the hegemony of English at a different level altogether. That's one. Secondly, in your lecture, you lamented about the disconnect with the Sanskrit. For me, the real problem is not the disconnect with Sanskrit, the disconnect with our own Indian languages. See, as a teacher, as a scholar of as a teacher, as a reader of literature, I don't know who is a great writer in Tamil, who is a great writer in Telugu. See, there should be a greater interaction between Indian languages. The emphasis should be on this, disconnect with Sanskrit.
I never mentioned that the connection, interaction between one Indian language and another Indian language should be stopped. No, I never said it. I want more and more interaction. I want more and more integration. But when you mentioned Sanskrit, Kuvempu, I tell you, Kuvempu had studied Sanskrit to a great extent. His knowledge of Sanskrit was really great. He had read English also. When he was the Vice Chancellor of Mysore University, it was he who said Kannada should be the medium of instruction up to MA and MSc, and English should become, which should remain, the library language. There is a distinction. English should become the library language and all the knowledge should come to Kannada. Therefore, we must translate all best works in all the subjects in the world into Kannada through translation. That is how we can develop our language. It doesn't mean everyone can read English. Everyone should read in the original English. This translation work should continue in all the languages.
Sir, may I just be permitted? Sorry, I am coming up again. On two issues, sir. Once he talked about English. English may have a wonderful dimension. It may be a language of liberation. But there has to be some balance between your culture and the liberation. You want to reach out to the world, global world. But what is the strength from where you are coming? The strength is the Indian strength, your cultural strength. You need strength to reach out, to jump higher in life. So you cannot ignore your basic culture to get away from liberation. Japanese are also liberated in the world, but they treasure their heritage. They don't break it. That's very important. So managing a good balance is very important, which is lacking in India. Now, connecting it to aspects of Sanskrit, I am a student of a central school, and I have studied Sanskrit in 6th, 7th and 8th. Like sir mentioned, that there is a need for exposure to Sanskrit to develop love for Indian heritage. Sanskrit gives it to you, and Sanskrit gives you uccharan. It gives you love of pronunciation, and that also helps you to express yourself, gives clarity, precision, like sir is talking. So nowadays in Kendriya Vidyalayas and central schools also, they have disconnected with Sanskrit in 6th, 7th and 8th. So there is a need to come back to it, sir. And one more small, with your permission, sir. Madam talked about that in the central schools, when you have a school in Kerala, for example, the people don't like to, there is a regional bias.
I will answer your question. I have understood your question. Why I am saying elementary Sanskrit should be taught is, since the majority of you are Hindi people, I give example in Hindi. You take most of the Hindi words and trace its the root of that word, it is Sanskrit. How you take any word, the root is Sanskrit. And if you know the root, you can write better Hindi. In the same way, if you know elementary knowledge, I can write better Kannada and one can write better Bengali. That is why I am pleading for elementary knowledge of Sanskrit. It should be started at our school level. That is all the point. And don't bring in any sociology. Sanskrit was the language of exploitation. It was the language of upper caste. Don't bring caste community, etc. It is uncalled for and it is dangerous and destructive. To
finish now, thanks. We have a very live and vibrant discussion because it's a very debatable topic Professor Bhairappaji has raised. Even whole day we can discuss on this topic, this how this the points he has raised. Friends, as I mentioned, the lecture what he has delivered today is going to be released, and thereafter you can have a copy of it. You can collect the copy from the outside counter and go through it, and whatever possible you can implement in your whatever he suggested to get our children in our own language, mother tongues, protecting and all. I request President Sahitya Academy to come on the dais and release the book and hand over the copies to Professor Bhairappaji. Professor Bhairappaji wants President's reaction to this lecture, so I request President to say a few words and conclude the program.
भैरप्पा जी की इच्छा है कि मैं भी इसके बारे में कुछ कहूँ. मैं भैरप्पा जी के वक्तव्य से पूरी तरह सहमत हूँ. और उनका यह कहना सही है कि मातृभाषाओं में प्रारंभिक शिक्षा, हम नहीं कहते हायर एजुकेशन दीजिए, प्रारंभिक स्तर पर मातृभाषाओं में शिक्षा देना हमारे बच्चों की मौलिकता को आगे ले जाना है, इसमें कोई संदेह नहीं है. दुनिया भर के भाषा वैज्ञानिक और भाषा चिंतक यही बात कहते रहे हैं. गुरुदेव रवींद्रनाथ ने बांग्ला में ही कविताएं पहले लिखी क्योंकि उसी में लिख सकते थे. बाद में उसका जब अंग्रेजी हुआ और सी एफ एंड्रयूज और वाई बी ईट्स वगैरह के हाथों से होके वो गुजरा और नोबल पुरस्कार उसको मिला, तो आपको याद होगा ईट्स ने अपने लेटर्स में, सम लेटर्स टू ईट्स, एक नर्तकी से प्यार करते थे और उन्होंने उसको कुछ लेटर्स लिखे हैं. उन लेटर्स में एक जगह उन्होंने लिखा है कि रवींद्रनाथ को अच्छी अंग्रेजी नहीं आती है. आप सोचिए कि रवींद्रनाथ टैगोर को अगर अच्छी अंग्रेजी नहीं आती है तो हम लोगों को क्या आएगी. इसलिए जो आपने ये कहा कि इंडियन इंग्लिश राइटर्स हमेशा दोयम दर्जे के नागरिक माने जाएंगे, ये बात भी अपनी जगह पर सही है. और जहाँ तक संस्कृत का सवाल है, आपने बहुत साफ कर दिया कि संस्कृत में सोशियोलॉजी और ये सब लाने की ज़रूरत नहीं है. हम संस्कृत टेक्स्ट को स्वीकार करने के लिए नहीं कह रहे हैं कि आप संस्कृत टेक्स्ट का पीछा करिए. आप संस्कृत लैंग्वेज इसलिए पढ़िए कि वो रूट्स तक जाएंगे. हम लोग हिंदी के पाठक हैं, अनेक ऐसे शब्द आते हैं जिन शब्दों पर हम लोगों को चिंता हो जाती है कि इसका रूट क्या है. अगर आपको संस्कृत रूट के वो शब्द पकड़ में आएंगे तो निश्चित रूप से आप सही प्रयोग करेंगे और उसके अर्थ तक पहुंचेंगे और उसको पल्लवित करेंगे. इसलिए मैं ज़्यादा, मुझे व्याख्यान नहीं देना है, मगर जो कुछ भी आज भैरप्पा जी ने कहा बड़े साहस के साथ, जो सब लोग महसूस करते हैं उस बात को इन्होंने सामने रख दिया. एक जिसको हम कहते हैं कि संस्कृत के आते ही कि ये पावर की लैंग्वेज है, और ये डोमिनेटिंग लैंग्वेज रही है, और फिर उसके बाद सोशियोलॉजी और इकोनॉमिक्स के सवाल उठाते हैं। वही हालत तो अंग्रेजी के साथ है। अंग्रेजी क्या पावर की लैंग्वेज नहीं है? अंग्रेजी क्या हमारे ऊपर थोपी नहीं जा रही है? हमारा सारा चिंतन क्या अंग्रेजी के वातावरण में नहीं बनाया जा रहा है? संस्कृत के 100 गुना इस समय हम अंग्रेजी के कब्जे में हैं। इससे हमको मुक्त होना चाहिए। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, और भैरप्पा जी को खास तौर से कि उन्होंने बड़े साहस के साथ हमको आगे खड़े होने के लिए एक थॉट प्रोवोकिंग सामग्री दी। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।